doing this for video. That's the setup here. So we're now going to take a look at how palliative care fits into the health insurance model. Our esteemed panel consists of Dr. Marcus Thygeson, Chief Health Officer, Blue Shield of California. In addition, I'd like to welcome Dr. James Mittelberger, Director and Chief Medical Officer for the Optum Center for Palliative and Supportive Care, and Jill Mendlen, Founder and President of Lighthouse Hospice and Palliative Care and Vice President for LifeBridge Medical Associates. Finally, we'll round out our panel with Judy Thomas, CEO of the Coalition for Compassionate Care of California. Welcome, panelists.
I think the first thing we're going to do is introduce ourselves. So I'm Marcus Thygeson, and I'm the Chief Health Officer at Blue Shield of California. We serve about 4 million of California's citizens, and I'm responsible for our medical management, quality management, pharmacy management, and health and wellness programs, and I also provide a lot of input to our provider engagement work, working with healthcare delivery organizations to improve the quality and affordability of healthcare in California.
And I've been introduced already at the conference. I'm going to pass it on to the other panelists.
I'm Jim Mittelberger. I'm pleased to have been the person that wrote the grant for the Alameda County Pulse Coalition many years ago, and worked in Alameda County helping build programs for vulnerable patients for about 25 years. In the past decade, I've been working with United Health Group. Currently, I am the Director and Chief Medical Officer for the Optum Center for Palliative and Supportive Care. What we're building out are multiple programs to improve care of patients facing serious illness, and every one of our Optum care organizations has specialty level team-based community palliative care as a part of our care model. So we're working out and have developed algorithms and understand some of the costs and benefits of these programs across the country. And so pleased to be working here to try and make palliative care, the goal is to make it just. It should not depend on you fantastic, heroic people being in scattered communities making what should be standard care available to people, trying to find a way that we build it into the system so that everybody gets it every day in every community.
And I'm Jill Mendlen, and as you heard, I'm president and CEO of LifeBridge Hospice. And a number of years ago, we saw the need to expand our services to really look at palliative care and went on a journey. And we elected to go and found a medical group. We have a specialty palliative care medical group. And in our group today, we do inpatient palliative consult for Palomar Health System. We do community-based palliative care where anybody, wherever patients of ours reside, so it could be in nursing homes, assisted living, anywhere in the community, their homes. And we also were fortunate enough, we have a number of managed care contracts with a variety of different models in terms of our palliative programs. We were fortunate enough to work with HealthNet when the California Healthcare Foundation went out probably 3+ years ago now, looking at partnerships for providers and managed care plans. And we've been a recipient of a couple of their grants, and so we've been working in that model for a number of years as well. And I'm very pleased to be here because I am a diehard palliative care fan. So thank you for letting us join you. We'll look forward to talking.
So now that you've met all of us, I've been asked to say a few introductory remarks about the work that we've been doing together. And you all have on your tables in front of you the first edition of the Community-Based Palliative Care Consensus Standards for California, produced by the California Advanced Illness Collaborative. And this, in all likelihood, is an organization or a group of people of which you have never heard before. And we represent that group, and I think we have projected, maybe? Yeah, if we could have the next slide. We've projected the names of the participants. And so I want to tell you the story of the California Advanced Illness Collaborative and how this all came about. And then also, there's an open invitation to the entire community to collaborate with us and to participate in this work. So I've been the chief health officer at Blue Shield for about 5 years, and prior to that, I spent about almost a decade in Minnesota working for a variety of healthcare organizations there, health plans and hospital system. And then before that, I was a practicing physician in Berkeley and also a leader in the local medical group, Alta Bates Medical Group. So I've spent the last 25 years of my life working to try to make the healthcare system perform better. And over that time, I've come to recognize that the healthcare system is an incredibly complex system, and that to make systems change and to improve their performance takes a very concerted effort. And so when I came back, and as in my role as chief health officer, I started thinking about what are the really pressing health issues or opportunities in our community to improve healthcare. One of the things that really surfaced to the top as a high priority issue was the problem with poor quality advanced illness or end of life care. And I'm this audience, I don't need to tell you the nature of those problems. You are all very familiar and dealing with that in your everyday work. But the other problem, the other aspect of this is there's also a significant implementation problem. Because the evidence about the value of palliative care is very, very strong. In fact, the evidence of the value of palliative care now is probably stronger than many of the non-palliative treatments that people receive who have advanced illness or in the end of their life. And that's actually true for there's a whole class of healthcare services. Palliative care is one of them, but shared decision making is another one. There's a whole class of services that we know are very effective and are best practice, but are not systematically adopted by the healthcare system. So we have an implementation failure. And my experience about addressing these kinds of issues is that you need to be very strategic in the way you approach them. No one organization in the healthcare system can by itself address that, and too often we tend to try to solve these problems in our own silos. And when that happens, we may be able to sort of optimize the performance for our own little organization, but we are not able to effectively address the social problem that we're trying to address. So as I thought about this problem, I thought, you know, we need to have a multi-stakeholder initiative to really take this on, because we're trying to change the culture and the processes and the structure of how healthcare is delivered in this state. And there's no one health plan and no one delivery system in this very large state that can do that. So what I've learned over the years in terms of these kinds of things is that it's a mistake to come up with a big fancy blueprint and then go out and tell people, here's the plan, all you have to do is execute on my plan. I tried that early in my career and it wasn't very effective. So I've adopted an approach I call emergent design, which is you start and you see what works, and then you keep doing what works, and you stop doing what didn't work, and you invite people to join you in that process, and whoever volunteers and answers the call adds value, and you collaborate with them, and you get smarter as the group works together as a high-performing group. And then you just sort of build on what works, you know, use a bright stars approach. And so as I was starting to think about how to engage in this, I was fortunate enough to be invited to a meeting with that was hosted by the California Healthcare Foundation, who has been a marvelous supporter of the work that we're all doing together in the state. And I remember being very impressed with the woman sitting to my right. She seemed to be very well connected in the palliative care community in California for some reason, and she had a very kind of sensible approach to, you know, how to move things forward. So I thought, you know, I bet Judy Thomas would be a good partner in this. She knows the community, she knows the field. I don't know it that well. So I approached her and I said, hey Judy, what do you think? What do you think about this idea of a collaborative that we get a bunch of payers and a bunch of providers together, and we need some consensus standards, because we need to have we need to get agreement on at least a sort of lowest common denominator approach to this that we could all sign on to. If it's too complex, you know, this plan won't want to do that part, and this provider won't want to do that part. But if we can come to sort of a lowest common denominator approach, we can all sign on to it, then we could all then like do a pilot in one community where, you know, if we're all doing the same thing together, that's going to send a powerful signal in that community. It's going to enable the palliative care providers to be successful because they'll have a consistent framework that they're working with the plans on. And it will also send a powerful signal to all the other providers because the payers, a big chunk of the payers, will be aligned for a substantial fraction of their members in terms of guiding them to use these services more often, make referrals, et cetera. And fortunately, Judy was gracious and kind enough to say, well, that sounds like it might be a good idea. So we decided, and then we had a series of preliminary meetings, and we then ended up with the group that you see projected on the slide there. Now, the goal from the very beginning has been that this will be a expansive and inclusive project. So if your name's not up there, don't be offended. It's not that you don't have a role to play here. And I'll say a few words at the end of our presentation about next steps and how you can be part of this. But we obviously, too big a group becomes unwieldy, so we thought about, you know, who might be willing and able to participate. And not everybody we invited said yes, by the way, but we were able to get a key group of people who have been meeting. It's been about a year and a half, hasn't it, Judy? Something like that. We've had a series of meetings, both in person and on the phone, over about a year and a half. And again, the goal was initially to develop some consensus standards, and that's what's in front of you. By the way, this is the first, it's not the first draft, but it's the first public version of this. And to the extent that there are opportunities to make it even better, we're open to that input. And now we're going to move forward and we're going to work together to try to find a community where we can pilot these concepts and demonstrate that we can really move the needle on these issues, really change care in a community, and then we want to scale that across the state. So that's the framework that we're going to talk about. Now I'm going to turn it over to Judy, and she's going to say a little bit about why the California Coalition for Compassionate Care was willing and interested to join us in this work.
Thank you, Marcus. I think you've given a great summary of the background and kind of the intention here. When Marcus first approached me, there were a couple things I loved about it. One, it was collaborative, which we always like to do that. Two, it helped us to strengthen a relationship with a key stakeholder group, which is health plans and payers. And traditionally, you know, when you go back to like the beginning of our work in the late 90s and the early 2000s, you know, some people would say, oh, well, let's get health plans to be the messengers about the importance of advanced care planning. And at that point, our discussions in the field were still too tied to withdrawing and withholding. And it was like, I don't think health plans are the messengers here. So the field has evolved to a point now, you know, really palliative care is a legitimate, it's a medical specialty, it's very well established within inpatient settings and hospitals. And the time was right to start looking at, you know, the reimbursement and the financing part of care and how this fits in. Because we know that payment drives a lot of what is provided. So again, it felt like the right timing to happen. And the process of developing consensus standards is something the coalition has done. The first project that we actually grew out of was developing consensus standards in skilled nursing facilities. So I said, you know, I was very excited about the idea and Marcus's vision and felt that we had the pieces that we needed here in place in California to move this forward. And I think California is kind of like big enough and yet small enough to be able to come together with a consensus process like that. You know, the other piece that was happening in the state is all the work that the California Healthcare Foundation had invested in with studying community-based palliative care. Again, palliative care had become pretty well established in the hospital setting. And so the next frontier for operationalizing palliative care was across the rest of the continuum or in the community. And California Healthcare Foundation had spent some time kind of studying what is the state of the art and produced a couple of reports on that. And then they pulled together, they had a project that funded payers and providers a dyads of a payer and a provider, sometimes a couple of providers, to plan. First, they did a planning process to plan what would their program for community-based palliative care look like. And from those plans, then California Healthcare Foundation funded the implementation of most of those plans, and that was their payer-provider partnership. So there were a lot of learnings that were coming out of that. It was showing that there was success, this could happen. At the same time, they were finding that these programs tended to be a little bit unique to those particular payer and providers that were part of it. And that they kind of were feeling boutique-y and not really scalable. And so we see the consensus standards as an important next step to spreading community-based palliative care in our state and laying this foundation that will facilitate scaling of community-based palliative care across the state.
Thanks, Judy. I've already said a little bit about why I think why payers think this is important. I'm going to, in just a moment, ask Jill and Jim if they could comment on the provider perspective. But issue here that I think actually Jim was instrumental in helping us focus on was that for payers, there hasn't been really a clarity around how we should pay for community-based palliative care. And that's actually one of the big gaps in palliative care delivery. There are financial models for office-based palliative care and for hospital-based palliative care, but there hasn't been a good financial model for community-based palliative care. And if a payer doesn't have a good model for that, and if they don't have confidence that that's going to have some impact on affordability, it's hard to get a payer's attention. So as we started this work, frankly, I was thinking pretty grandiose and pretty global about all the ways you could improve palliative care in a community. And Jim was instrumental in saying, you know, here's this one focused gap. We don't have a good business model and a model for paying for community-based palliative care. We need that. And that's really then what the collaborative focused on as our first sort of step to move this forward. So I just want to acknowledge that another beautiful example of the wisdom of the crowd. Jim, I wonder if you would be willing to sort of talk in terms of your experience. You have a national perspective with the Optum organization. So why is it important to have a common set of standards for this work?
Okay, well, let's just take a look at our current payment and structure of our healthcare system, centered around the more you do, the more you get paid. I mean, there's rules, you have to justify what you're doing. And most of what you do is either going to happen in a hospital or a doctor's office. Now there are home care and there's other pieces that are very important, and there's hospice, which is very, very important. But the system is really centered on hospitals and homes. And what happens when you're frail and vulnerable and you start having a serious illness or you have an acute catastrophic illness? You have a hard time expressing your wishes, you have a hard time getting care. You end up not getting what you need at the right time in the right place, and you get physician-level care usually in the hospital, and it's usually inordinately expensive. And for those of us who are here, it's a huge design failure in the healthcare system because there's a lot of suffering that happens because you're not getting the right care at the right time, and nobody actually talked to you about what you wanted. That capture kind of the picture? So basically, why do we have this design failure? We have a lot of good people that are, and I think I started to break it down in terms of payment, was we have a really hard time paying for the right care at the right place at the right time. And sometimes that care, it's interesting, that care, because it is team-based care, basically. And it isn't just a disconnected nurse or social worker or even a disconnected doctor working in the home. It needs to be a team providing specialty level care, sophisticated level care in the patient's home or in a nursing home. So basically, if you understand that the right care at the right time in the right place is this team-based care, then you start to develop a system that pays for a team and values the team performance. So that was one part of it. And I'll tell you another part of it, which is the real part of it, which is It's very expensive to do that sophisticated team-based care in the patient's home. So I've been in the real world out there. We all want to just believe if we just created it, massively expanded it, and scaled it, it would solve the healthcare system's problems. I'm unfortunately here to say that that's not really true. You have to really identify the patients that it's an expensive service, and some patients doesn't yield value. You have to identify the right patients, and you've got to kind of keep some pressure on the system to give them the right care at the right time. So I think it's a really important problem as we look to innovate in our healthcare system coming from the patient-centered perspective. And I will say that what we are doing in California with this model, trying to develop a pilot, is also being mirrored. There, the Center to Advance Palliative Care, I sit on a national task force looking at how we're going to develop payer-provider partnerships and how we're going to solve this. And the American Academy of Hospice and Palliative Medicine also has a task force looking at, and we're developing an alternative payment model. So what we're trying to do on a state level here to develop some models is happening. It's a problem that people across the country are looking at. How do we make sure that we encourage the right kinds of delivery of care by the right kinds of people that have the right motivations and can succeed?
Thank you, Jim. So Jill, I have a question. My question for you would really be as somebody who's actively engaged every day in terms of providing these services for people in California, how could a set of collaborative standards like this influence and help you improve your work?
Well, I think, and I appreciate it, Jim, your comments really about the magnitude of these programs and the expense of operating them. And as I said, we've been operating a palliative program since 2009, and it's been a significant investment, not only of dollars, but resource of our teams. And I think part of the challenge, I was thrilled to be part of the collaborative effort here, because we see many different models still today. So we have a number of payor contracts, and they're all different. And so as we operationalize them for our teams, it's different because under this contract you can do certain services, under this contract you cannot. This group wants certain outcomes, this one is looking at something else. And then you throw in the middle of all that, and because we are a medical group, we can certainly do some Part B billing. So what do you do with the Part B world? And now you have MACRA and MIPS and everything else that we are trying to adapt to in that program. And so looking at basic standards, as you have, and Marcus, I compliment you for having the vision to start to look at this. I think it's critical for us because we can't figure out how to staff these models unless there's some type of consistency. We can't figure out the data analytics that we will need. I mean, the questions earlier in terms about looking at data, the more we standardize, the better our benchmarking abilities will be, improving our efficacy and the outcomes that we do. And also, I mean, there is, I always say, guys, you know, in the real world, I've been in healthcare since I was 15, so at this stage of my life, it's a long time. Although you don't have to, you could think it's only like 10 years, right, really, is you have to follow the money. There is that real part, because if we do not, it doesn't matter what our passion is, it doesn't matter how much we care. We always laugh and say we'll be the best program that went out of business, right? And so I think going down this path and the things that we're discussing is critical. And I had one experience along the line, Jim, of what you're talking about. I created a program in New York. I have another operation there. And we created it for a high-risk population, just what we're talking about here, advanced illness. And everybody loved it in the plan. They loved it. I had a plan partner, a joint venture. And I ended up with 1,000 people in this program. And we were doing great work, and it cost a fortune. And when they finally realized, oh, yeah, we love you, but you're burning huge amounts of cash, and we're like, yeah. We've been telling you that. We shut it down. So I have lived through many iterations of these programs, and so I'm thrilled to be here with you today to share the good and the bad of those scars and to see us move forward. So thanks, Mark.
Thank you. So I'm going to just walk us through in the panel with the consensus standards. So if you have them on your table. Just a little bit of background and context there. And the consensus standards cover patient identification, so who is eligible, what are the essential services, who are the providers, who qualifies as a palliative care provider, When do patients qualify to be disenrolled? So not just when you come on, but when do you go off? Payment models and payment methods, and then measurement and reporting. So those are the topics covered by the consensus standards. And within patient identification, you know, our focus was to set a floor, you know, something that could be a minimum as to who would qualify for palliative care. Now, a plan can always pay for additional patients, but we wanted to have a floor that seemed very reasonable to all the plans. And we structured it as general qualifications and specific qualifications. And the patients are expected to meet all of the general qualifications and at least one of the specific qualifications. And just so the general qualifications are this late stage illness, looking at their health or their functional status, it's in late stage of a medical condition. And again, this isn't all of palliative care. This is palliative care that's being provided in the community in the person's home. So if we can kind of, again, we're not defining all palliative care, but for those who would be eligible to have a benefit of a team of providers coming in to the home to support them. So it's really that late stage where they're starting to manage their care by going to the hospital or using the emergency department. So they do have needs and need significant attention. And the current system is kind of not really structured. It's kind of failing them. Of course, if they're assessed, they can stay in their home. It's an appropriate place, and they have that support they need. We're not wanting to swap people from hospice to palliative care, so this is not for the hospice patients. These are people who are prior to hospice. And again, we don't want to swap this out for people who really have the more of a psychiatric or substance abuse issue. So we're looking at those people with advanced medical condition, and that's their primary issue. And then the specific disease-specific criteria, we're focusing on people who have advanced cancer or congestive heart failure, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and end-stage liver disease. So those were the ones that the group came to a consensus on. And then we did have, you can see under five, other diagnoses, because sometimes there are people who don't fall into one of those criteria, but really do have a very significant medical condition that would benefit. So I'm going to turn it to pose a question to Jill first to elaborate on, you know, the importance of having, specifying which patients are eligible and these criteria that we've laid out here.
Well, I think we had a lot of discussion about which patients we thought would come in and into the program initially, and as you said, Judy, these were kind of the guiding standards. We figured we'd try to start with a more defined population because, you know, even though we're diehard out here in the palliative and certainly hospice area, when you get into the bigger system, there is still great debate about who qualifies for palliative care, what kind of patients should you refer. And we jokingly say, if you've seen one palliative care program, you've seen one palliative care program. And that really exists. And it is interesting. I mean, I was working with one of our medical groups in San Diego last week, and the case manager was sending us over a patient. And as she's describing this individual to me, effectively, this patient has failed everywhere within the system and refuses treatment, no matter where she's been. And she's been in the hospital with palliative providers and everything, and she wants to send this individual to our community program with us to do something magic. And I can tell you, I don't think anything magic is going to occur. And so in her eyes, that would be a failure in the palliative program. And so I think defining the kinds of patients that we serve, clarifying that, and again going back to saying that is a way for us to begin in a structural way to say if these are the patients we're serving, what is the data we can you know, ascertain from the experience, what are the outcomes we see, and we start to really kind of paint our picture, because when we stay broad and we stay in a way a bit Wild West out there, I would say we can't demonstrate really the great programs that we offer because it's too diffuse and too many things are moving through. And and even in our program, we have seen an evolution of where we would say we had classically people in the last year or so of life, if you will, depending on how you want to define palliative. We have seen that morph into some ways to very clinically complex multi-comorbid individuals who are certainly not in their last year of life, and that's a very different population. The metrics will look different. The staffing is probably different. So, Judy, it's all of those reasons. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to the essential services, which you can see fall into assessment, treatment, and care coordination. So assessment, it's really what we, in the consensus standards, saying it's important to assess the individual, what are their needs, and then create that individualized care plan for that person. Keeping in mind also in looking at the caregiver, because these people, caregivers, are a part of the medical team and help to keep the person out of the hospital. With treatment, it's offering services, palliative care in the home, wherever that person is living. Looking potentially at telepalliative care. 24-hour, 7 days a week symptom management, the group felt that that was important, that these people have access to that kind of support. That's what helps keep them out of the emergency department. And helping them think about what are their treatment wishes through advanced care planning and getting that documented, naming a surrogate, completing a post if appropriate and wanted. And then another key piece was care coordination. Because these people have advanced medical conditions, there's often multiple physicians and healthcare providers that are involved in their team providing care, but often in very different parts and fragmented parts of our healthcare system. So expecting the palliative care team to help be kind of that central point to bring some of this together so that there's not duplicate services, so the gaps are filled, and we know what the other members of the team know. So that's it in a short summary, and I'd like to ask Jim to elaborate on how describing essential services is really helpful.
Well, just a couple quick points. We are in palliative care, we're trying to create another level of support, not another level of confusion, another layer of confusion. So we felt it is essential that communication and coordination with all the existing providers be a required part of this program, because otherwise we could potentially be causing more problems than we're helping. We also believe this is a multidisciplinary transprofessional service, and to establish basic quality standards, so we do believe it requires social work, nursing, and physician engagement, so that is required. And that will help raise the bar to require people to put that together. And finally, we think patient needs happen 24/7, and any program that's knitting care together really needs to be available to patients and other providers at the time of care. So setting a floor for these basic requirements we thought was essential.
Great, thank you. So another element of the consensus standards is defining who is a palliative care provider. And it's palliative care, so we definitely want a team approach, an interdisciplinary team, because this is whole person care. And so it's helpful to have different members of the team who have training looking at different aspects of a person's medical situation. And we set a floor as to the minimum or team members should include a physician, an RN, a registered nurse, a social worker, and availability of a spiritual care professional, whether it's a chaplain or another member. So we really felt that you needed to have all of those four to really have a palliative care team. But we know that there's a lot of other members of the team or healthcare professionals that could be helpful, and different organizations may configure their teams differently. So we do acknowledge that there could be additional clinical or even non-clinical staff such as advanced practice clinicians, pharmacists, home health aides, community health workers, and care coordinators. So again, I'm going to take it back to Jill to kind of elaborate on the value of having that spelled out.
Well, I think to establish, as you've heard Jim and Judy say, to establish a floor of what we believe a quality team should look like. And again, that was an area we had a lot of debate. But I think by starting with a defined team for all of us who are trying to build palliative care programs, it gives us a basic area to start with and understand what the expectations are. And it is really around that, as you're building models, you have to obviously do a financial analysis of what does it cost to try to build that base of professionals. And it also helps the payers as they're looking to say, well, what are we asking for? And what I've truly appreciated with both Jim and Marcus in their leadership is that they have been willing to take a look and say, if we're going to define this, then we also have to look, how do we pay the providers for this? Because these are our expensive programs. And so I think by doing the work that we've done and setting the threshold, it helps our payers look at what they're trying to purchase, if you will, from the provider community. It helps us as providers to say, okay, this is the expectation, this is the model that we need to build for this relationship. And if we can make it more standardized, that will be much better from the provider side and probably even somewhat from the payer side, certainly in terms of data and things for us. So it's better for us that way.
Thank you. I'm going to cover disenrollment real quickly. This is relevant because we want to create a continuum of palliative care ultimately, but these consensus standards are looking at a specific time and point in that continuum. So we need to know when do people come on and when do they go off. And so we're not here duplicating hospice, and some of this I think is pretty straightforward. But from a plan perspective, it's really important again for them to be able to know how long will these services go on, and so having an endpoint spelled out is helpful. So moving to the payment models, which is really a key factor for these services, is form follows payment. We felt that it was important to say that the payment should be value-based, not fee-for-service. So that's kind of the big reason why we don't have palliative care spreading across the continuum right now is because our healthcare system is still largely fee-for-service based, which rewards interventions and more intensive and complicated interventions, whereas palliative care is not. And that's kind of the point of palliative care, is to be the counterbalance to that in our healthcare system. So really looking at that more of like a general price or a rate suggested per enrolled member per month. So for each patient that is on the palliative care service, that is enrolled in the palliative care service, the payment is a flat rate per month. And that we did acknowledge that there may be incentives for quality or for cost management. Marcus?
In terms of why that's important, I think I'd say maybe three main comments. One is obviously, as Jim actually indicated at the beginning of this whole presentation, one of the major problems in the American healthcare system in particular is this fee-for-service model that pays for throughput, not for outcomes and quality. And we, as payers, we certainly do not want to perpetuate that. We want to move to a pay-for-value model. The federal government to date has been a strong advocate of that in the government programs as well, and we're, as private payers, we think that's a really important move in the right direction and actually a critical, important system change to drive a higher value healthcare system. But there are some other practical things as well. The entire healthcare payment system is set up to pay for certain kinds of providers but not others. And so, for instance, at Blue Shield, we have no way to contract with, there's a growing set of healthcare providers that are not necessarily licensed by the state of California, they're not mentioned in the Knox-Keene Act. Our systems are difficult to configure to actually include them as providers. Our legal teams are anxious about including them as providers. And so, operationally, we couldn't actually pay fee for service for a lot of the kinds of services are delivered by a palliative care program using our traditional claim system. On the other hand, if we're paying a bundled per participating member per month kind of payment to a palliative care organization, we can manage that operationally. Furthermore, one of the challenges with the fee-for-service payment is that You know, it locks everybody into a certain set of behaviors that are then very hard to change, and it inhibits innovation. And basically what it does is the only innovation it promotes is innovation around revenue maximization. And that's one of the reasons why we have such a high-cost healthcare system, right? If we're paying for value and we're particularly paying a bundled payment, that liberates the care delivery organizations to innovate around how do we both improve the efficacy of our programs as well as the efficiency, right? And because they're not tied to some, you know, revenue stream attached to what the doctor did. So we think for all those reasons, value-based payment is actually a critical part of this model. Jim, do you want to add anything?
Well, I think innovation is one. We should not only get paid for sitting in front of somebody, but if we can get the same outcome by calling them, talking to them on video, achieving the outcome with a community health worker, the system should do that. The other thing is I'd like to point out that how many people here have ever actually had a schedule of people that they're taking care of, either as a physician or a nurse, a social worker? You look down your schedule. Okay, not everybody. There's probably some people who've been on those schedules, though, here. Most of us have been on those schedules. How many people here, we're going to be honest, cone of silence, turn off the video. How many people have looked at that schedule and seen that there was a whole lot of easy stuff that day and said, "Woo, I really didn't want to add much value today." Anybody? I've been there. So we've got to create a system that really rewards the time that you do add value, that you make those meaningful connections. And if the system doesn't do that, I do believe we need to be honest. This field of palliative medicine can generate waste. We actually could end up having conversations that don't add value. We've got to make sure that we're measuring the quality, that we're really making a difference to patients and families, to person-centered care, and that we're really focusing our care on the people that need it. So we need quality outcome measures if we're going to make this thing work.
Great segue to the last of the consensus standards, and that's measurement and reporting. And so we broke it down into process and outcome. I think there was some discussion earlier today about how we don't have nationally standardized and benchmarked measurement for palliative care. But what can we measure today? Definitely process measure the number of patients who were seen, how long were they on the program, did they complete, engage in advanced care planning and complete a document. So process measures. And then for outcome measures, we want to look at things like how did the patient and the family, what was their level of satisfaction? And then how did this impact their utilization of other healthcare resources? Did they continue to go to the hospital or the emergency department? So that's our thoughts on what we set for measurement in a nutshell. Marcus, do you want to elaborate on that?
Yeah, obviously this, as Jim indicated, is a critical component of value-based payment. And you know, obviously just paying per participating member per month without actually measuring outcomes and the quality is another form of fee for service, basically, right? You're all familiar with the adage, you know, if you don't measure it, you can't manage it. And certainly, we have lots of healthcare going on in this country where there's no accountability for outcomes. We don't want to replicate that model. I think this may be the component of the consensus standards where we have the biggest potential for improvement. I think that what are the right quality measures for palliative care is still somewhat controversial, and we didn't actually put a lot of specificity, if you'll notice, into the document. There's no NQF reference number attached to any of these measures, National Quality Forum reference measures. We did want to focus on concepts or measurement concepts that are recognized and commonly used in the field. We wanted to prioritize those that we think would be relatively easy and feasible for the provider organizations to collect and report back on, so they could build that into their operating process and be actively managing those things as they do the work and be continuously improving, as well as in sharing back with us their performance measures. And likewise, to the extent that these are measures that the payers will be collecting and reporting on, we want things that are relatively easy to measure and report on. I don't think this is a complete set yet, and I think it's one of those places where as we go forward with this collaborative work, we'll sharpen the concepts and get better at coming up with a very well-defined set of measures, but this was an initial framework we wanted to share with folks. The other thing I would say is that the payers are certainly interested in this initiative and these programs delivering the known value that they have demonstrated in terms of the ability to reduce unwarranted utilization. But that's not our only focus. And we're also very interested in our members experiencing better quality of life, and in their families and their caregivers experiencing better quality of life. And we're very interested in them experiencing a longer life. And to the extent that palliative care continues, as the early studies indicate, to actually prolong life expectancy for people with certain kinds of conditions, we're interested in that as well. And I wouldn't want to give anybody the impression that we're just going to narrowly focus on, you know, cost savings from palliative care as a way of measuring the value. So I'm going to kind of bring us to a close here, and I'm going to actually explicitly make a call to action. We've all in this room and many of our colleagues outside in the state have been working for many, many years to address this problem, and yet the problem continues to persist. And we've made some progress, but we have a lot more progress to make. And if you're interested in joining this effort and participating in this initiative, if you want to give us feedback about the work we've done to date, if you'd like to participate in it going forward, and especially if you would be interested in participating in a regional pilot, we're very interested in hearing from you. The contact information is Leah Morris, who is the Director of Policy and Payer Relations. She's standing in the back of the room waving at you. Her email address is at the bottom of page 2 of our document. And please send her an email and let her know how you would like to participate. It could be just that you identified a typo in the document, or it could be that you want to, you know, be part of a pilot, or you want to, you know, you have a benefactor and you want to donate some money to the California Coalition. Any of those things, I'm sure, would be greatly appreciated. So. And by the way, you know, you don't have to wait for any of that stuff. You could actually go out and start testing out these standards now in your own organization and give us feedback. One last comment I'm going to make, and then we're going to open up to Q&A. Another key part of our decision making around these standards was we wanted to map or mirror as closely as possible the SB 1004 standards that the DHCS is developing for palliative care and Medi-Cal. And I think this is actually a good example where you have a good initiative going forward at the state level, at the regulatory level, and then for various kinds of reasons that might get put on hold, but the private community can move forward and make progress, and we have the opportunity to implement these kinds of standards and test them out and actually build the evidence base that will provide strong support for DHCS when they finally get this work back going again. Give them further evidence that the community is ready to do this, and possibly even some outcomes data that would help the legislature be supportive of the work. So that was another part of our decision making on this. So that's enough from us. We have a little time left for Q&A, and we have microphones scattered around the room. We'd love to take your questions. Sure.
Thank you very much. I'm Michael Fratkin, Resolution Care. I just want to make a comment and acknowledge that you de-emphasized prognosis as one of the strongest and most mysterious factors that restricts access or shortens the length of access to palliative care services. I just want to acknowledge the importance of that, I'm sure, a very intentional choice and conversation. And then I want to open for comments from you about people that fall outside of the typical well-defined clinical buckets, also appreciating the discretionary category. That is an appropriate place to put in this concept of prognosis. But can you talk a little bit more about that last category of other and the kinds of collaboration that'll be needed between providers and health plans?
Yeah, so you know, plans typically set sort of relatively sharp boundaries around what they are legally committed to pay for. But we have the ability to flex beyond that at our discretion. And so what we wanted to do is set a set of standards that most, if not all, plans could say, yeah, the evidence is there, that makes sense, I believe that I can afford to put that into my benefit design. The plans always have the option of flexing. The only place where we have limitations on that, frankly, is in the Medicare benefit, there are limitations on our ability to offer different benefits from the Medicare standard. And thank you for the acknowledgement in terms of not, you know, de-emphasizing, not eliminating, but de-emphasizing the issue of prognosis. So I'm going to go over here and allow another question from the right side of the room.
Hi, I had a question. One, I want to say thank you for the incredible amount of work and detail and comprehensiveness of this document and the consensus and the work you're doing going forward. So thank you for that. The other question, is this a consensus, is it based on becoming a primary care provider or being an adjunct to a primary care provider? Do you take over all of their care or do you work with, you know, a primary care person as an additional level of support?
It wasn't our expectation that this would displace or replace the primary care provider relationship. Did anybody else want to say anything about that?
I agree.
Yeah, we all agree.
We're aligned.
Yeah. Wells.
Thank you. This is really uplifting progress, and this is the way things happen in California. Thank you for this great work. One of the things that Governor Brown's Let's Get Healthy California Task Force pioneered was to look at every health metric that could be subdivided by race or ethnicity or one of the other criteria for health disparities would be included prospectively in their evaluation of some of the innovations that they were doing. And I would really encourage you to do that as well, since average performance often leaves some people at the curb, and would really hope that you could incorporate that in our diverse state.
That's great. Thank feedback. You. Thank you.
I'm curious if you might talk about any conversation that was had about why volunteers were not listed as part of a program, especially as we're talking about palliative care as a social movement, and this is a way to be engaging the community. Just was there conversation about that, and what was the thinking?
I can make a comment. We had a lot of discussion about who should be included, and I think part of the concern was as we're building the initial very, very beginning phase of the model, and we were trying to set up a kind of a standard protocol, if you will, that we decided, at least from our initial discussion, that if we just kind of defined the basic bare root of the team, because you could add many, many different components, and I probably spoke in terms of keeping the more defined team narrow, because as we build these programs, if we keep adding, you know, we're adding different things, we might not get there. So I'll take part of that onus in terms of some of that discussion. I don't know, Marcus.
But I don't think that we wouldn't exclude volunteers.
Oh, no,
and
that's
programs right. That want to use volunteers in their program design, there's no reason that they couldn't. Again, this is just the sort of bare minimum expectation. Does that answer your question?
Sure. I'm just hearing more palliative care programs talking about using volunteers for advanced care planning and things like that. And there's just a part of that being a requirement in hospice that makes sure that the hospice stays connected with their community. And so it just seems like a nice little infrastructure piece to stay connected.
So that's a good takeaway for us to go back and think about. Would we want to make a requirement there be a volunteer type activity?
It would probably go under here.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. On the left.
Hi. Oh, sorry, I'm kind of short.
I have a couple questions having to do with the continuum of care going from home health to the palliative care idea, okay? So with home health, you have to be homebound, otherwise you can't get the service. So I noticed that that was not listed in anything that you talked about in this wonderful document, and I'm hoping that that will not be a criteria for being able to be part of the palliative care program. The second thing is, though, I noticed that you did not include PT or OT as part of the team. And it seems to me that if we're really going to have a true continuum of care, we've got to blend these things a little bit better, okay? Because what you've done is blending beautifully with the hospice. I can see that wave flowing easily into hospice, but it's a little clunky going from home health to palliative. So I'm wondering if there's a way, when you're looking at the criteria for admission into palliative and you're looking at the criteria for admission into home care, and seeing how those two things can flow together a little bit better. Because I've been out in the community for 10 years, some of them doing home care, some of them doing hospice, and there's always been this gap. And I'm thrilled because we're finally addressing the gap. But we need to make sure that those home care nurse case managers can flow right into being a palliative care case manager, right? Because it's the same job. I mean, we've been doing it for years under the radar, right? And by the way, since there's an insurance people here, I'd like to mention that it's a little upsetting that apparently every home care agency loses money on their nurse visits. So we're kind of the glue that holds the whole thing together out there. And, you know, over the years, turns out, well, they pay the physical therapists a lot of money, but they don't pay a lot of money for nurses. I don't know why, but I'd love it if you could fix that.
Thank you for those helpful suggestions.
I'll just take, I think the goal here is not to, with this generation, is not to replace in any way the hands-on care that are provided to homebound patients. I think ultimately, maybe our goal would be a fully integrated system. This is and this is not on the basis of being homebound. This is a basis on need and risk, and that is to require that would be to miss some patients that really do have a need for service in their home, even if they don't meet the Medicare homebound requirement. So I think that if you think about it, this is a different service than the hands-on services typically provided by some or much of our home care benefit.
Yeah, and some of this clunkiness is caused by federal regulation. So if you're on Medicare and you're eligible for home health, you have to be homebound. And we can't do anything if you're being paid under that. But this is designed to be paid under a capitated managed care, accountable care organization of your bundled payment. And so that's why it allows us to get out of some of those restrictions.
Over here on the right.
Hi, I'm Ann Murray. I'm a hospitalist and palliative care physician in Ventura. I would love to see dementia be one of the diagnoses in this. There's so many patients that I see that are not yet a 7C. I can't get them qualified for hospice. They're a 6. They're going to be a 6 for another year or so, and this would just be ideal. So a couple questions. Jim, the specialty care at home, do you envision that including things like IV Lasix for a heart failure patient, or maybe IV fluids and a couple doses of Rocephin for UTI so that dementia patient doesn't come back in? And then my other question with the value-based purchasing, does this allow for a team that has a massage therapist, an acupuncturist? I assume that's what you were alluding to, some of the providers that cannot contract with plans.
I think the answer to the second question would be yes. The intention is to allow palliative care organizations to get creative, if you will, and provide services that wouldn't ordinarily be payable or covered necessarily by a plan. So, and could you restate your first question?
The specialty care at home, can that include things like putting in an IV?
Well, you know, it's interesting. It's the same clunkiness we have. Ultimately, we need a system that has this care planning capacity, the specialized care planning coordination, and 24/7. So obviously, if you're providing 24/7, you should be able to do home infusion and IVs. How much would actually be covered on this payment? I am not entirely clear. We need to listen carefully to understand how does this fit into existing home infusion contracts and payment. But you're right, it needs to be knit together. I do think it would be the responsibility of a community-based palliative care program that identifies a patient that's suffering from shortness of breath to be able to arrange all available resources, and I do think we should be able to do home infusion. It certainly makes a lot more sense than sending somebody to the hospital for the wrong care at the wrong place. Mm-hmm. So I agree, it's a need that we need to, it's a really important need. Thank you for sharing that. We need to try and make sure we build a system that fits that in.
Hi, thank you very much. Laura Petrillo from San Francisco. I'm a researcher, and I was wondering about your choice of outcomes measures. I know this is a completely unfair question because there isn't a good answer, but when you're talking about the concept of measuring quality of life as an outcome, you have listed on your working document patient and family satisfaction, which is just a tiny fraction of that and sometimes may actually lead to some perverse incentives. And I'm wondering if you could speak to what the group's thoughts are kind of at the moment about what might approximate some of those concepts that you're trying to, that you would try to capture with outcome measures.
I'm glad you asked that question. As I said, this is a place where I think we probably need some help. When I think of outcomes, I think about, measures of functional status and quality of life. I think about things like, in retrospect, did I have the kind of life experience that did I die in the location that I preferred? Those are things I would want us to develop measures to focus on. I also think important outcomes are. To what extent was I forced to use or be dependent on or be exposed to the healthcare delivery system, and as opposed to being able to spend time doing things I enjoy? I have yet to meet, maybe I've met a few patients with Munchausen's, but other than that, I've yet to meet anybody who actually likes spending time anywhere near a medical facility or their doctor's office in general. And that includes most of my patients who liked me personally, but I'm sure would have rather been doing something else. So I think actually treatment burden would be another good outcome for us to be able to measure. To what extent did we relieve people of the burden of having to use or spend time dealing with the healthcare system? So those are outcomes that come to my mind, and we'll be very interested in other people's thoughts about good outcomes. Does the rest of the panel want to respond?
We're working on this. You have a frail, vulnerable population, and their caregivers are often frail and vulnerable. Probably giving them a 32 question questionnaire on quality of life as a starting point is not the answer. We're looking at it. I think we're looking at some objective measures, days of life at home, if that's a desired, it's not always a desired outcome, but it usually is a desired outcome. Pain and symptoms are really interesting and challenging for us because it turns out pain is a big problem for a small subset of this population, but it is not the primary issue. This is very different from inpatient palliative care where pain is very often the primary problem. The vast majority of our patients do not describe pain as their most bothersome symptom. So how do you define the problem? So we're moving to things like net promoter score and things like that in terms of would you recommend this program? Did this program make a big difference for your quality of life? So, but I'd love to talk to you afterwards. We are working with Prescani and others, experts across the country. This is really important. Measuring what matters is really important. And I don't know that we have the right answers yet.
Thanks. Over here on the right.
Hi, my name's Patricia Ruppelt. I'm a physical therapist, so I just noticed there was that physical therapy or occupational therapy weren't included in the team. And I've had the opportunity to work in a team approach at the VA in hospice and palliative care, and I felt like I could be a really valuable team member in that situation. Obviously yesterday there was a lot of talk about function, and that's totally what we do. And then also fall prevention to keep people out of the hospital in that regard. and also getting people reconditioned after hospitalization, things like that. So I just want to make a plug for that, that I feel like sometimes to bring physical therapy in the cases where they're needed, then it's sort of lost in the team approach towards patient care because we're not really part of the team, we're just an adjunct service. So I just want to make a plug for us. I think we can be valuable.
Thank you, thank you. On the left.
Hi, Red Wing Kesar. I run a community-based palliative care program in San Francisco in a social service model. And to quote Diane Meyer, not from her interview yesterday telling us that death should not be discussed in palliative care, but something she said last year at HPM, which was that social supports are medically necessary. And I see in your report that, you know, there needs to be a social worker on a team to help navigate the healthcare system. But I know that Blue Shield is looking at what it means to actually provide some of those social supports, like respite care for burnt out family caregivers from non-medical caregivers, transportation to appointments, meals on wheels, some of the things that cause the most suffering for people when they don't have it. And are other payers looking at how to include those kinds of actual, real, on-the-ground supports as part of this?
Yeah, thanks. That's a good comment. And that makes me, one way I might interpret that into kind of an actionable thing would be that I don't think we've really maybe necessarily addressed the benefit set that might be implied by these standards. I have to think about that a bit. I'm not going to go on record saying that that's the case, but we certainly have been looking at our benefits and modifying them, and I know that other payers in the state are doing that as well. But as I think about the document, I don't think we've actually necessarily specified what kinds of benefits around things like social services, social supports, the payers would be expected to offer as part of this. So it's a good
Marcus,
call.
Can I just make a little comment to that too? Can I? I think a lot depends on the individual contract because we have some that are very specific and others that are very prescribed in terms of what we can and cannot do. And others, I would say that Blue Shield is one of the more open model, if you will. I mean, that allows us to use our best creativity of who we need to bring to the table to get the outcome. So I don't. Again, when we came together, and I think the goal was to try to create a document that we could maybe get consensus from a number of plans across the state, and that if we got very specific in many different things that we might lose, you know, their focus. So we felt, I think, that it was better to start kind of somewhere to get us on the road than to do everything that we might have liked to do and maybe not evolve as quickly. So is that a fair comment, Marcus and Jim?
Yeah, I think it is. I think it is. But obviously, I agree with you that supporting those kinds of social determinants and social services that people need is an important thing we need to be thoughtful about and try to identify some best practices. So we only have about 2 minutes left. So I think we'll take a question over here. And depending upon how long the question and answers, you might be able to take one more over here.
Okay, that's a little bit of pressure there, but I'll try. So my name's Marie. I'm an RN and a director of a home care agency up in Redding, California. And I am excited to say that we meet all the criteria of a home-based palliative care program. It's really exciting. And just to address the therapy, it's really what does the patient need? So if they need therapy, even if it's just for maintenance to keep them out of the ER, we provide it. So therapists are an integral part of our program. But here's my question. I was really pleased to see that Dr. Wolf was on here with CMS, because 80% of our patients are Medicare beneficiaries. And in this world of value-based purchasing, you know, in our star ratings, we have our performance measures and our outcomes are very, you know, functionally based. And often, you know, when you're transitioning a patient from traditional home health and palliative care to hospice, their functional scores are not so good. So what I would like to know is, where are we at with CMS and Medicare beneficiaries and them taking a fresh look at the needs of a palliative care patient?
So I'll take a swing at that and then I'll let others comment. So we've kept Dr. Wolf informed about our work. She was actually, unfortunately, not able to actively participate in the meetings, And the challenge with CMS, obviously, is that the benefit set is, and particularly on the fee-for-service side, the contracting is all driven, you know, at the federal level out of Washington. And we haven't yet been able to really engage with our region to see whether or not there's any kind of creativity we can do on the fee-for-service side. On the other hand, we are actively thinking about what can we do for the Medicare Advantage population, where the plans are basically the administrators and own those products. So we may have some opportunities to make progress there. The other thing I would say is that Blue Shield, and I'm sure other payers as well, are working at the national policy level to work with CMS to try to come up with innovation pilots. So for instance, we're actually working with a group of hospice organizations at the national level to try to come up with some proposed pilots. For instance, reintegrating the hospice and the Medicare Advantage benefit to see whether or not we can't make progress in the Medicare Advantage sphere and pilot some of these innovative models to generate data that then CMS could use to modify the Medicare benefit generally. So that's kind of how we're thinking about that issue. But it is a major challenge because obviously so many people who could benefit from palliative care are you know, Medicare beneficiaries in one way or another. Does anybody else want to comment on this?
I just say a number of our organizations are collaborating with other organizations to educate the new administration on the value of palliative care and the needs of seriously ill patients.
Yeah, just to point out that we are. I'm also working with the American Academy of Hospice and Palliative Medicine. There's the CAPC is working on this. I think the exciting part about and the responsibility we have in California, two things: having one, making this available to everybody and making this a part of standard medical care to include Medi-Cal and Medicare and commercial without having all the variation is a very exciting thing. And frankly, I think in this period of time, for a lot of reasons, a lot of the innovation will happen at the state level. That's us, folks. I mean, in California, we have, I think a lot of this, we may get some waivers or permission to do things if we're lucky, but I think a lot of it's going to happen here.
Awesome. Thank you.
Okay, well, listen, we're out of time. I want to thank the panel. I want to thank all the participants. I want to thank Leah and Tori Fields on my team who have really been the drivers. We're just the pretty faces. They've done all the work. I think Jim's last comment about the excitement about getting organized around a minimum set of standards and going forth and getting all the payers engaged and moving the needle, that's what this is all about. We welcome your support and participation, and thanks for your attention today.
Okay, we have a few announcements. Number one, as soon as I let you go, please move out of this room very quickly as we have to turn it around for lunch. So network outside. There's some cool posters for e-patients that they're willing to share that's across the hall. And we're going to take a short break, then head across the hall to Regency D, E, and F for today's set of office hours. This is a free-flowing session, and you're welcome to move from one topic to another. Also, for those of you who registered for a vegan lunch, and you had to register when you did your registration, go out to the desk and get your vegan ticket, okay? And I think I've got everything. Thanks.